like losing to nobody and nothing. It makes me sick in my stomach.
Feeling that fate had dealt them a bad hand, these proud competitors turned their luck around and are now the comeback story of the year. Having won four of their last five games, this determined group of warriors shows no sign of slowing down, thanks in part to rushing leader John Avery.
Don't talk to me, because I can back it up.
From here on out, everybody in trouble.
The enforcers now control their own destiny. A win tonight will guarantee a spot in the playoffs.
Springtime conditions in the beautiful city of Chicago, Illinois. Temperatures reaching into the 70s. A beautiful day to contemplate a big football game. We welcome you to Soldier Field for the final game of the XFL's regular season. Tonight, the Chicago Enforcers try to nail down the final playoff spot against the league's best team, the Orlando Rage. New York has beaten Birmingham to put the pressure on Chicago. Here's the situation. If Chicago wins, the Enforcers are in. They'll play at Los Angeles in round one of the playoffs. If Chicago loses, New York goes to the playoffs. They'll travel to LA in the other game. San Francisco travels to Orlando. Just moments ago in the Chicago locker room, Ron Meyer addressing his team.
You're the best team in the XFL, guys. You know that.
Hey, fellas, check it out.
No doubt.
Hey, whatever I do for y'all. You know what I'm saying? Hey, I was blessed enough to get that bread when I went first round. But guess what? This for y'all. You know what I'm saying? If I hurt myself, I hurt myself for y'all. You know what I mean? Because I know y'all do the same thing for me. So either we do it now or we don't do it at all.
All right, everybody, touch somebody. Come on, everybody, touch somebody.
Touch somebody now.
Touch somebody.
Come on.
We're set for the scramble for the ball. Scott Kloman for Orlando, 5-3 against Chicago's Tony McCall, 1-2 for possession of the ball.
All right, guys. All right, fellas. After I blow the whistle, no holding, no block and blow the waist, I'm going to tell you to take your marks. When you're set, I'll blow the whistle. All right? Take your mark.
There they go. Tony McCall.
Chicago's won the toss.
He has it for the Enforcers. A vote of confidence for the Chicago Enforcers. Hi, everybody, along with Brian Bosworth, I'm Chris Marlowe. Well, if you're a Chicago Enforcer, it's just the way you want it. You control your own destiny. Chicago wins, they're in. If Chicago loses, however, because of tie-breaking procedures, the New York, New Jersey hitmen are in. Okay, Boz, the big story in Chicago this week, the health of John Avery 2 weeks ago, injured his hamstring. How is he? Can he play?
Well, Chris, John didn't practice at all this week. He's gotten a lot of treatment. He's been stretched. He's been rubbed. I spoke with him about 20 minutes ago in the locker room. He doesn't know how effective he'll be. He says he's going to go. He's going to try to do as much as he can. But you know what? If he goes, or he doesn't go, it's not the John Avery show here in Chicago. It takes more than just one player. It's going to take all 38 players to play flawless football to beat the best team in the XFL and lock down that last playoff spot.
The Orlando Rage heading towards an undefeated season before their star quarterback, Jeff Brohm, got hurt. Last 3 weeks, they've been adjusting to the new quarterback, Brian Kucklick. This is a guy who's very talented, but sometimes erratic.
Actually, some say more talented than Jeff Brohm. He's bigger, he's stronger, he sees the field better, he can throw the ball deeper. His only problem has been his decision-making. He's had 9 interceptions over the last 3 games. So the big question today is, can he make the big plays without the big mistakes?
John Avery, there was talk that if New York had lost today, that you would get some rest. But the table is now set. The hitmen are now in. Your team needs you big today. How effective can you be?
I don't know. I mean, God willing, I'll be able to do what I've been doing all season long. If not, you know, we got LaShawn Johnson. He can step up and make plays. But I'm going to give it all I got. This is it.
Brian Kucklick, you've clinched home field throughout the playoffs. How are you going to play with abandon today against a team that has everything to play for?
We need
some positive momentum going into the playoffs, and we came out here to win. That's why we came to Chicago.
Galen Hall, the head coach for Orlando. He has 2 wins from 100 in his coaching career. Last 6 years coaching in NFL Europe, and Ron Meyer. In the NFL, he was the 2-time AFC Coach of the Year. 1 year as an agent, he tried to recruit the boss, but he said the boss was too expensive. He couldn't afford him. Weather is gorgeous, the best Chicago weather we've had since we've been here. Temperature dipping into the 50s, humidity not a factor, and the forecast is clear. So set, ready to go. Andy Crosland will kick off for Chicago, and Brian Shea is deep to return. Shea sat out last week with a knee injury, very explosive, averaging over 25 yards per return. We'll see if his knee can hold up. We're underway. UPN primetime football. And Shea fields it at his one. Out he comes. Runs into his own man, and down he goes. So Brian Kucklick, 6'3", 29 years old, out of Wake Forest, as Brian Bosworth detailed. He's thrown 9 interceptions, 3 in the last 3 games. But at Wake Forest, he put up big numbers, over 8,000 yards, 40 touchdowns. He's got a big arm. Once again, as Boz told you, sometimes he makes some questionable decisions. So that's the big story for Kucklick tonight. Can the Orlando Rage play error-free football? Derek Clark opens as the running back. First and 10, hand the ball to Derek Clark, swinging to the outside. And Clark powers his way near the first down line. Kerry Cooks making the tackle. So Kucklick, you know, his last game against Birmingham, props his best, Boz. He threw 3 touchdowns, but the interceptions really come out and grab you.
Absolutely. And the one thing that's probably good out of the 2 games that he had to come back from was that they know they can come back if they get down. The question is, can they stay and be dominant for the entire game without throwing those costly interceptions?
8 yards on the play for Orlando. Second and short. Give to Derek Clark. Orlando's going to be very close to the first down. They should have it with that run. Derek Clark, 29 years old. He started his collegiate career at Florida State. And it is a first down. So Derek Clark is the featured back, number 43. We're going to also see a lot of Mike Black, number 21.
Yeah, you're probably not going to see a whole lot of Brian Shea. They may try to hold him for the playoffs. He's an explosive part of that 3 tandem in the backfield. But I tell you, Derek Clark is one explosive runner himself.
The initial first down of the ball game to Orlando, and the first pass for Brian Kucklick on a short roll. And he throws to the normally reliable Dialleo Burks, the Rage's leading receiver, in and out of his hands. So an incomplete pass.
Simple rollout. Brian gets outside containment, puts the ball on the money, and Dialleo, little lapse of reason there, doesn't come down with the ball. He's usually very sure-handed. Looks like he was trying to run a little bit before he got the catch.
Now, if you're wondering about the Chicago enforcer defense, it's the second worst scoring defense, the XFL's worst total defense, and the worst passing defense. So Orlando should be able to make some yardage. Derek Clark stretching for about 3. However, the one good thing about the enforcer defense, they come up with big plays. They lead the league in interceptions.
Absolutely, and Coach Ron Myers credits that secondary for the second half being on fire.
And we've got a clip.
Crackback 81.
The crackback.
Bottle foul. Where were you?
Back here. Right here. Yes, sir.
15 from here. Second down.
Called out on Dialleo Burks.
What's your formation? Personnel.
Deuce.
You got it already?
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
Galen Hall, 18 years as an offensive coordinator at the University of Oklahoma, 6 years as the head man of Florida. And so they mark it off against Orlando.
Smolies.
How much was it? How much did it penalty?
Wymack on one.
That's a big penalty.
That's something that doesn't get called a lot. Blocking below the knees.
No.
Almost a crackback block there by the wide receiver.
So a second and 23. Mike Black checks into the backfield. Kucklick, short drop. He's got some time, and now he runs out of time as the enforcers are in very quickly. Aaron Humphrey made the early hit, a 23-year-old out of Texas. A loss of 7.
And you're going to see Aaron Humphrey play all over the place on that Chicago enforcer defense. He'll line up at linebacker. He'll line up at defensive end. He's played big all year long. Hubert Thompson in there as well. And that's one of the things that they're really going to have to be cognizant of, is trying to get pressure on Brian Kucklick and force him to make some bad throws.
Aaron Humphrey having a great year. And now the crowd comes alive. Opening series. It's a 3rd and 28 for Orlando. 3 wide receivers for the Rage. And we got a marker down. And the clock has expired. It's going to be delay of game.
Number 14.
And you can see a lot of the mistakes already happening for Orlando. This is not what Galen Hall wants. They want to go into that playoff with the kind of momentum they had the first 6 weeks of the season. And over the last 3 weeks, they've kind of lost that momentum.
And you have to wonder what kind of motivation Orlando has in this game. They've clinched the division. They're already going to be the number one seed in the East. Have they come out a little bit flat? So a 3rd and 33 for the Rage. Mario Bailey in deep motion. Kucklick fires short.
Football.
Pass was complete. It's kicked. And the Rage in on it. So the enforcer, Chicago, has it.
The first big play goes to Chicago. And Coach Ron Meyer told us this week that they've got to focus on trying to get turnovers early on in the game.
Pass was complete to Skinny Culver, and Ray Austin knocked it loose.
Good underneath coverage, just got to come up and make a play, and that's exactly what Ray Austin did.
Ray Austin gets it.
Quincy Culver with a big hit.
The righteous take the kingdom by force, baby.
So Chicago starts with LaShawn Johnson. So LaShawn Johnson starts as the running back. John Avery on the bench.
Ray, how huge a play. You guys need to score early. You need to get some turnovers. That was gigantic.
That ain't nothing but defense. The righteous take the kingdom by force. The righteous take the kingdom by force.
The sons of thunder.
Pause. What does that mean, the righteous takes the kingdom by force?
That's biblical, Bubba.
Okay, what does it mean? I'm going to kick some booty tonight?
That means if you're righteous, you deserve the kingdom, and you take it by force.
Kevin McDougal out of Notre Dame.
Go!
He's 4-1 as a starting quarterback, over 59%. Last week, he threw 3 touchdown passes. It's 2nd and goal. LaShawn Johnson hits the hole, driving inside the 5, maybe to the 3. Tackled by Bill Duff.
And I think this is smart by Coach Ron Meyer by starting LaShawn Johnson this first series. Don't put John Avery in a position where he can get hurt early. They got the ball down deep in Orlando's territory. Go ahead and put LaShawn Johnson in there and let him bang it in there.
Johnson over 100 yards last week. And there is number 20, John Avery, the XFL's leading rusher. Nearly 800 yards, so they're going to hold Avery out at the moment. You can see he's dying to get in there, but his man, LaShawn Johnson, doing okay. It's 3rd and goal from the 2. McDougal on the roll, throws, and it's incomplete.
Boy, they came in awfully early on that one. Should have been a defensive pass interference.
Looking for his tight end, Ty J. Armstrong, out of Mississippi. And a 4th down coming up. So bring on the kicking unit.
What did he say about
I don't know. Ask him. Get on the phone right there and ask him.
Andy Crosland, who's had 2 of his last 4 blocked. 2 out of his last 4 blocked. Not all his fault. Breakdown in pass protection. This is a shorty, a 19-yard attempt. That was a bit high. And Crosland boots it through. So kind of a completely different cast. Jeff Brom had a big game. So did Dialleo Burks. John Avery running wild. But now it's up to Brian Kucklick. So 3-0 Chicago leads, although Chicago has to be a little bit disappointed. They could not punch it in with a 1st and goal. Chicago to kick off deep is Brian Shea. High and short. Shea at the 8. Drilled at about the 23. That will be a candidate for the Lugs hit of the week.
Big time. Heel straight up in the air. Carlos Timmons. Yes, sir. Coming right at you, Brian Shea. Ouch.
Timmons out of Eastern Kentucky. He must have thought Shea was from Western Kentucky.
That's why they call him special teams. A special player is only one to play special teams. And kickoff coverage happens to be the biggest collision-like special teams on the field.
Opening drive for Orlando was complete disaster. Drop passes, penalties, and a turnover. So Orlando's second possession at their 29. Derek Clark looking for room, cuts it back. Clark, a very effective runner. You don't consider him a breakaway specialist, but if you need 4, 5, 6 yards, he's a good bet.
Absolutely. He's a big pounder inside. You know, ironically, they've had so much success in their running game, but not one of their three backs, Derek Clark, Michael Black, or Brian Shea, has broken the 100-yard mark barrier. As a matter of fact, I think the longest run has been by a quarterback, and that was Jeff Braun.
New York has already won. The Hitmen putting a beating on the Birmingham Bolts earlier today on TNN. We'll show you highlights of that at halftime. Chicago in a must-win situation. Kucklick rushed, and he loses the football. And Chicago may be on it again. Let's see. Was Kucklick down?
It didn't look like he was down. They might call him down.
Don Sasa involved in the play. The big fella out of Washington State.
Brian Kucklick hangs on to the ball a little bit too long. He's got to get rid of the ball. He has to be able to feel that pressure. That's a scramble for the ball. I tell you what, I think that ball comes out before Brian Kucklick's knee hits the ground. Orlando gets away with another one.
Number 94, Don Sasa, making the play.
Go!
And it's a third and 10. Kucklick throws high to Bailey. He's upended. Coming up quickly was Jason Bray and the Chicago D. There's a complete difference in the emotionalism of Chicago. Orlando looks dead right now.
No question about it. The team that wants it the most is going to win this football game. And right now, Chicago wants it bad. Take another look at Brian Kucklick and whether or not he had that control of the ball before it comes out. I tell you, he doesn't have control of that ball, and Orlando's been very fortunate with the lucky calls today.
Corey Ivey deep. And Ivey gets a couple. The U.S. Army presents victories in life. Tonight we look at L.A. running back Saladin McCullough.
Prefontaine
into the end zone.
You knew something.
A high school quarterback in San Diego.
His first professional touchdown.
Make the pitch.
Biggest game of the year.
Look out. He gets the pass off.
And then Maddox a little bit later to Copeland. The Xtreme dominating the Demons. Demons flat after their big win 2 weeks ago. And if you look at the playoff potentials, Los Angeles played Chicago early in the season, 139-32. L.A. rubbed out New York in week 5. Those are the playoff possibilities. New York has won. Our congratulations to Charlie Polari, who came in for New York this week, replaced McGuffey, who got hurt. And Polari leading New York to a win, but will it be enough? And now John Avery has checked into the backfield for Chicago. So Avery playing with an injured hamstring. Let's see what he can do. First pass complete in the flat to Aaron Bailey. McDougal with a short gain. Steven Fisher coming up to make the tackle.
And I like that call on first down. Coach Ron Myers needs to mix up the first down package. It can't all be about the John Avery show with guest star LaShawn Johnson. Even though they need to do well, you got to be able to mix it up on first down.
Quickly, boss, do you use Avery as a decoy here?
I think I try to use Avery as often as possible to decoy the defense and try to keep him out of harm's way today.
Two tight ends. Fake the ball to Avery. McDougal hit as he throws, incomplete. In quickly was James Roberson out of Florida State, getting his arm up, whacking hard.
James Roberson beaten. Tony Ramirez off the block. Tony's got to get back and get a little bit better block on Roberson. He can't let Roberson come in and get a free shot on McDougal like that.
Rage defense, fifth in the XFL in terms of points allowed, averaging 18 points a game. They don't take the ball away. Kind of a solid defense, a bend, don't break. They give some yards, they give some points, but they win most of their games.
They score a lot of points.
And they don't make a lot of mistakes. We got a couple of whistles, no flags.
What happened, baby?
We got it. We got it.
Hey, guys.
It's a second and 10. Spot the ball at the 49.
A 3-on-3, Bob.
22 to nothing. New York motivated. Rusty Tillman and company doing their thing.
You know, Charles Polari just needed to get out of New York to kind of shake off that New York dust and see if he's actually a pretty good quarterback. You just got to give him a chance.
Kirby Dardar, a 77-yard touchdown from Polari. So New York has done their job. Short pass complete to Junior Lord. And now New York has to hope that Orlando can get a little motivation, can get a little energy. Is it hard to manufacture that, Boz, when you're flat?
Not when you're playing for $100,000, it's not, because these guys are all getting paid the same amount of money, but the bonus check at the end is why they're out there playing.
3-0 Chicago. 5 minutes and 20 seconds to play first quarter.
And this is what Chicago doesn't want to be in third down and long. You don't beat Orlando if you're going to sit in third down and 4 and 5 and longer.
McDougal, deep drop. He's rushed and hit. And the second sack of the game, it's Bill Duff.
And again, he beats Tony Ramirez. To come to Tony Ramirez's defense here, he's got two bad wheels down there. And Bill Duff, he got nothing but big RPMs coming at you.
And we've got a flag in the secondary. Junior Lord.
Contact 35 Orlando. Five in the first down.
Was locked up, and it's going to go against Orlando.
Big break for Chicago here.
Number 35, defense.
Stephen Fisher.
From the previous spot.
And Junior Lord. So Fisher, who's a minister in his spare time, battling with Junior Lord.
Now, McDougal doesn't even get a chance to get back set up and look downfield before he has to start the escape route there.
John Avery continues as the running back. First down, Chicago. John Avery going to carry the ball this time. Sidesteps a man, bursts up the middle for about 4.5.
And he said the word burst there. When I talked to John Avery before the game started, he said the thing that has affected his game so far with his hamstring is his burst. He's got the speed, but it's that burst that helps get him away from the defenders.
First week at Orlando, he ran wild. They couldn't tackle him. Last week, however, he just had 7 carries. Then he didn't practice the entire week.
Are you going to get a quick toss and a John Avery
Blue
run right now?
Blue 191.
Second and 7. McDougal hums one to the outside. Bailey. And Bailey's got the first down. Aaron Bailey is the top enforcer receiver. He came in with 27 catches.
I tell you what, that's going to be a key matchup today. Aaron Bailey and Stephen Fisher. We're going to take a look and watch that all day long, because Aaron Bailey's got that sneaky speed. He'll set his player up, and then he'll sneak him into a deep route, and then he'll burn him.
Aaron Bailey, the former Indianapolis Colt, goes wide right. It's a first down for Chicago. The enforcer's on the move, leading 3-0. Leverson in motion. They fake the reverse. Avery pops a hole on the left side, and he's got about 6. Cedric Clark coming up to make the tackle.
And you know, that's not the John Avery that I saw 2 weeks ago prior to the hamstring injury. He didn't shoot through that hole with that John Avery speed. He got through it, and he got 6 yards. But 2 weeks ago, John Avery's in the end zone with that hole. He's dancing. He just doesn't have that burst of speed that he has if he didn't have that hamstring injury. And I've had a hamstring pull, and it does weigh in the back of your mind because you don't want to pull that thing.
Second and 5 for the enforcers. The ball at the Rage 23. Blitz coming. Avery scoots off left tackle, and Avery goes down near the 15. Lewis Riddick coming up to make the grab, but not before Avery gets 8. And we've got an injured player down for the enforcers.
Cover that, John, man.
Let's go. Great call on a storm blitz right up the middle here. Kevin McDougal does a great job of getting the ball off, does a great job of finding a hole, weaving his way in as much as he can. And that's the thing with John Avery does. He has the ability to find a hole where a hole's not there, and he just did it right there.
And kudos to Chicago center, number 74, Paul Janis. He picked up that blitz and allowed Avery to get outside. The 8th play of the drive for Chicago. It's Avery again. He's going nowhere. Coming through quickly was Corey Mayfield. a former Oklahoma Sooner, and an academic All-America, a la Brian Bosworth.
They picked up Corey in the middle of the season to help provide depth, and I tell you.
Depth and intelligence, Bos.
Absolutely. Absolutely. I don't know many Oklahoma football players that aren't smart, too.
Nope. They're all academic All-Americans like you, Bos.
Match up.
3-0 Chicago. Brian Bosworth along with Chris Reggie, Michael Barkan, I'm Chris Marlowe. A big game that will determine the final playoff team. And McDougal is going down for the third time. Omar Brown coming in from the left corner position. McDougal, before this game, Bos, sacked just 7 times. He's gone down 3 times already today.
Absolutely. And you know what? The offensive line has done a great job. And here, the offensive line can't do anything because of bringing a safety on that. McDougal hasn't had a chance to get back set up and look downfield yet on any pass play yet today.
That's a good blitz. Avery taking the man in the middle. You're trained to take the inside guy and the outside guy coming up very quickly.
They come in unchecked sometimes.
Blue 44.
So third and 20 now.
Blue
Orlando's defense starting to stiffen a bit here. McDougal screen pass. Avery dropped it. John Avery came in with 16 catches, averaging 18 and a half yards.
John did the cardinal sin there, trying to catch the ball with his hands. You need to cradle that ball as it's coming into you right there.
And once again, good pressure.
Well, I don't think he left him alone, you know what I'm saying?
See, the average 18 and a half yards leads the XFL for Avery.
He's dangerous when he gets the ball out there, especially when he gets it in space.
So a 42-yard field goal attempt coming up for Andy Crosland. On the way. He got it.
2 for 2 today for Andy. He was 5 of 10 prior to those last two, so he's done a great job. He's been all the points on the board for Chicago today, 6-0.
Well, and Ron Meyer, his coach, said it was his poorest game as an enforcer.
Yeah.
And yet he still got XFL Player of the Week, so he played pretty good. 3 touchdowns.
He wasn't as patient as Ron Meyer would like him to have been during the course of the game. He rushed some of his throws.
6-0 Chicago. 19 seconds remaining first quarter. Brian Shea is deep. And Crosland the kick. Very, very short this time. Returnable at the 15. And a good run back by Reggie Doster. Doster bringing it out near the 28. There's a new show that UPN has. It's called Chains of Love. This is a show where you're chained to 4 members of the opposite sex 24 hours a day for 4 days. And it premieres Tuesday, April 17th at 8, 7 Central, right here on UPN. That's the end of the first quarter. We're coming back. Chicago leading Orlando 6-0. After these messages, we'll be right back. You're watching the XFL on UPN. 79 is right guard Sean Love. The offensive line for Orlando, considered one of the best in the league, Bos. Dan Collins at left tackle, Jason Gamble left guard, Cal Dixon at center, Sean Love, Jeremy Akers, Vince Merrill, the tight end.
They've been very fortunate this year that starting lineup has been pretty much their starting lineup all year. They haven't been hit with that injury bug down there.
Go!
First and 15, Mike Black takes the handoff. Black breaks through a hole and he's out past the 30 to the 32. A run of 8 yards. Ray Austin, the XFL's second leading tackler, taking him down.
Now some of the things the Orlando offense needs to do today to control that ball and control that line of scrimmage is they need to throw on first down, and they tried to throw on first down prior to this play, but it was a penalty. They should continue to spread the wealth. They get so many weapons on Orlando, it's hard to cover all of them. They need to limit those forced throws and just take what that defense the Chicago is gonna give you. And they should go ahead and pound that front 7 of Chicago.
One of the enforcers shaken up. One of the biggins. That's number 86. That's Terrence Houston. The And so they'll take him out. We should tell you that Dan Goodspeed is wearing number 83. He's an offensive lineman, but he will play a little bit of tight end.
That's the one position that they've gotten hit with the injury is their tight end. They're down to the third tight end this year.
Second and 7 for Orlando. Mike Black.
All day.
Let's roll.
Gets 3.
Let's roll.
All day.
A little kicking and shoving there.
Let's roll.
That could have been a penalty.
There's so much on the line right here for Chicago. They're going to play with as much emotion as they can muster up, as long as they can keep it up. And that's the only way they're going to beat the best team in the XFL.
Mike Black told us this week he'd like to carry the ball more. And it's really three running backs by committee for Orlando. 3rd and 4. Kucklick looks off a receiver, completes it to the short side, but he's going to be short of the first down. He needed 4, he got 3.
That's a good spot.
Vance Houston should have gone downfield a little bit more, at least to the marker. So if he caught the ball and got tackled immediately, which he did by Kerry Cooks, he would have at least had the first down. Kucklick takes his second receiver. He just doesn't get downfield long far enough to get the first down.
Jay Taylor, considered one of the best in the league, set the punt. The ball will be live at the 38-yard line. Deep to return is Ivy. Wow, that's a boomer. Ivy at the 5. Ivy trying to get around the corner. He can't. A tremendous special teams play by Kevin Jefferson. Jefferson chasing Ivy down. John Avery, he grew up wearing number 33. He loved Tony Dorsett of the Dallas Cowboys. Then in high school, he discovered Barry Sanders, number 20. He's been number 20 ever since.
Who can blame him? That's probably one of the best running backs that ever donned a football jersey.
By the way, the girl in the hit is okay. Her name is Rachel. She is tough.
Got that tough New York nugget.
Chicago starting with 4 field position. John Avery. Once again, in case you missed it 2 weeks ago, on the final play of the game, John Avery pulled a hamstring against Birmingham. So they're talking some stuff. Avery playing sparingly last week, getting treatment for the last couple of weeks.
Yeah, it was questionable to bring him in that late in the game to try to ice a game that, in my mind, was already in the freezer. I don't think you bring your star in to try to get a first down when you're 13 points up. Now it's affecting him.
Blue,
if it cost him the game, you know, Coach Meyer could get the GOAT award of the year.
McDougal guns it over the middle, pass complete to Luke Leverson.
And for the first time, Kevin McDougal had time. He got a chance to scan the field, and that's what Kevin McDougal has done all the last 5 games, which is really where they've made their big mark. He's got time. He finds Luke Leverson over the middle, and Luke does a great job of finding that open spot and getting the first down.
Leverson last week caught 2 balls for 2 touchdowns. He's become one of McDougal's go-to guys. 1st and 10, Chicago, leading 6-0. As Willie Tate in motion, it comes Avery back the other way. And Avery gets to the 26-yard line before he's corralled by James Burgess and Omar Brown. In case you missed it, New York has beaten Birmingham. The Hitmen putting the pressure on the Chicago Enforcers. Now Chicago has to win to get into the playoffs.
Let's go. John not being totally effective so far. But like I said at the beginning of the telecast, it's going to take all 38 of these enforcers to beat this Orlando football team.
The Bush update, New York 22, Birmingham nothing. Now New York having to hope that Orlando can get its act together. So far it's been all Chicago. Loose football and recovered by Kevin McDougal.
Come on. Got to do it quicker.
Go back and look at what happened there on the center quarterback exchange. And you look at the center. The center's got one of those big gloves on. The center's got actually playing with some brass knuckles in there. He broke his hand early in the season against New York. Something doesn't affect the snap. He doesn't use that hand to snap with. But you know what? I don't think you ever get a holding call on Paul Janis.
That's number 74. He snaps with his right knee, whacks with his left, boss.
388.
3rd and 10.
388. Set. Hunt.
Blitz coming. McDougal whips it out. And the pass is complete, but it's going to be way short of the first down. Junior Lord gets five. Omar Brown gets the tackle. And a fourth down coming up. So the Orlando defense has toughened up a bit, but the offense still questionable.
It's Chicago's inability on second down to get something started to keep them out of third down and long. Chicago knows that if they stay in third down and long against Orlando, they're not going to be able to move the ball effectively.
Skinny Culver is deep. Crosland high. Beautiful punt. Skinny's got it. Skinny's pursued, and down it goes. He loses the football, but the ball is down. The official says the ball is down, and Orlando gets a break.
Deshaun Johnson shot out a cannon there to make that tackle on special teams.
You know, we've seen a lot of plays like that this year where that exact play is ruled a fumble, not that time. So Galen Hall's offense will start up from the 22.
Kenny Culver, the Oklahoma State guy. Can't get away from LeSean Johnson's speed.
Timeout call, less than 9 minutes. Very sluggish. Brian Shea carrying the ball for the first time. He finished his collegiate career as the all-time leading rusher with over 6,900 yards. Wants to be an FBI agent when he's through with football. They've always said he's too small to play football, but it's really not. He's big, but he's short. He's 5'8".
He's probably the best little big man on the field. He's got so much heart. He's hard to tackle. It's hard to see when he gets behind those big offensive linemen. He can make big plays out of nothing.
So Galen Hall looking for a spark for his offense to hand the ball to Shea again. And Shea takes it up to the 30. 5 yards for Brian Shea. Ray Austin, who seems to be everywhere.
Third and 3 or 4. Let's go.
Jamie Baisley also helping out on that. Jamie Baisley came off last week, one of the biggest games of the year for Chicago, and came down with probably the biggest play of the year for Chicago in that fourth down interception. We can talk about that maybe short a little bit later in the telecast.
Baisley, the XFL Defensive Player of the Week. Three runs right here. Brian Shea breaks through left side.
There it is.
And Brian Shea tackled from behind at the 46. We've got a flag. And Dialleo Burks was mixing it up with Quincy Coleman. A gain of 15, but Burks and Coleman. And this may go against Dialleo.
It looked like the way he had Quincy Coleman shaking his head. Quincy might have goaded him into doing something he shouldn't have.
He sure did. He sure did.
Against Orlando is going to cost him big time.
I think Coleman cracked him.
Yeah.
Burks retaliated, and the official saw it.
You always catch the second guy.
15 back, personal foul, 81 offense. From here, 15 back.
Look at him thinking he's all innocent. You know, he's sticky with something in there.
Personal foul, 81. Offense, 15 yards from the end of the run. Repeat, second down.
So Dialleo Burks utilizing a maneuver that Brian Bosworth made famous, the shift to the nose.
You ain't doing that. Now Dialleo just comes up. There's no reason for that, Dialleo. You're not even in part of the play, and you just take away a big first down for your team.
So Burks is out, and Orlando, instead of a first down, it's going to be 3rd and 3. So Quincy Coleman, Corey Ivey, the defensive secondary, playing well so far. Brian Kucklick, the former Wake Forest star, hands the ball Brian Shea. And Shea has the first down.
Way to go, break.
Good blocking on the right side. Sean Love, Jeremy Akers, center Cal Dixon. I tell you what, if Galen Hall had his way, he'd like to run virtually on every play, grind it out, get a little bit of a lead.
Absolutely, and I think that's what Ron Myers is worried about today, was that they get so successful in that running game. If it gets going early, it's hard to stop it, so they may have to go to an 8-man front to slow that down, which is going to then give Brian Kucklick those open spots downfield.
Shea stays in. They reward him with another carry. So Shea gets four. Brian Shea doing some work. He's 23 years old. He went to Emporia State. Interestingly, he was a wrestler in high school. Got some scholarship offers from big schools, but decided to go to tiny Emporia State, where he set all kinds of records.
You know, he also said in his hometown there was one light in his hometown. So that's a small town. I grew up in a small town when I went to visit my grandfather. We had two lights. So
yeah,
it was a small town. One light town's got to be almost tiny.
Grandpa Bosworth making it into the show. Okay. Kucklick on the money. Pass caught by Lawrence Hart. Hart going to be short of the first down.
Good job of making sure tackles after the catch and not giving up those yards after catch that they did early on in the season.
One tray, 15 pounds, on one.
Kucklick this year, he's thrown for 5 touchdowns, but 9 interceptions.
On one.
3 in each of the last 3 games.
On one. Go! Center!
3rd and 2, Mike Black. He's got a first down. Mike Black at midfield, and he's tackled, upended by Dorian Brew. And if Brew doesn't get his hand on the ankle, he is gone. 13 yards.
Dorian Brew saves a touchdown for Chicago. Mike Black, this is what Mike Black gives you, that burst of speed that you don't get from Brian Shea. He's very patient with the way he runs, and he also finds that hole. Okay, if Dorian Brew doesn't make that play, this is a different ball game.
Dan Collins had a terrific block, sealing it off for Black. 6-0, Chicago leading Orlando. Mike Black right up the middle on the offensive line of Orlando is getting a big push now.
And you know,
Danny Beasley making the tackle.
And Chicago's defensive line might have the toughest job of the year for them. They've got to create pressure on Kucklick while not allowing that running game to get going. And right now, they're not getting that push on that offensive line to keep the running game from keeping it go.
Fitzpatrick, Sasa, Hubert Thompson, and Matt Finkus, the front four. There's Big Don Sasa. Quit the team early in the season. Now has come back to add some beef to that offensive line. Ryan Shea back in. Orlando on the move, 2nd and 4. A fake to Shea. Kucklick with running room, and he's tackled from behind. Aaron Humphrey.
And again, Aaron Humphrey lines up in that defensive end position. Because of his speed, his athleticism, he can get off the block. He doesn't lose contain, and Brian Kucklick's got nowhere to go. Does a great job of pushing up field and coming back, fall back inside and make the play. Nice job by Aaron Humphrey.
Chicago defense has really improved this year, Bob. They started out a little bit disorganized. They started out at a 3-4, went to a 4-4, but now they've got their act together.
I'm on.
10th play of the drive for Orlando. It's a 3rd and 4. Shea, tackle for a loss.
And that's what Chicago needs to do on the big third downs. Come up with the plays that turn the momentum of Orlando's offense.
Larry Fitzpatrick knifing in from his defensive tackle position. And Orlando forced a kick.
Fitzpatrick gets off the block, comes up underneath, and makes a big play in the backfield against Brian Shea.
Taylor to kick. It will be a live ball at the 16. Corey Ivey is deep along with Leverson. High spiral, it's a beauty.
Gonna have to field that.
Wow. And they're going to get number 26 for a danger zone infraction. It looks like he stopped 5 yards away. Reggie Doster down early, stopped, backpedaled, but still got called for the flag.
It's hard to judge that because you got the ball. You can't see the ball number as a defensive player.
23.
You got the ball high in the air, and the only guy that can see it is Corey Ivey. Doster has no way of knowing where that ball is coming down, so he's got to be able to give that 5 yards cushion, and it's hard to backpedal when you're going forward.
You know, if I'm Doster, I just take him out. Just rip the guy.
Well, then it's 15 yards.
Well, that's okay.
And you make the highlight package.
Well, you make the lugs hit of the week, you take him out, you don't get the penalty for nothing. Coming back, 6-0, Chicago.
Orlando winning that battle in Orlando, 26-14, but it was a pretty good game. So look for that to be an explosive game itself.
Speaking of explosive, the Chicago cheerleaders.
Pretty explosive, is that what I'm saying?
I would say amongst the best in the league. Amongst the best in the league.
They're all pretty good.
Chicago
Blue,
leading 6-0, 2:43 remaining in the first half. Low scoring, the Orlando defense getting its act together. The Orlando offense has been flat. Cedric Clark making the tackle.
This is the kind of pressure that McDougal's had to endure all day long. He just hadn't had time to step back, set up, and find a receiver. The one time he did, he was able to connect downfield with Luke Leverson.
2nd and 7 for the enforcers.
Blue 191.
Blitz. And McDougal throws. It's complete. threw a floater out there. Junior Lord gets a couple of yards.
McDougal got hit pretty hard on that rush blitz right up the middle. Again, he's under so much pressure. He's lucky to get rid of this ball. John Avery's not able to get inside. Burgess coming inside, making a pretty good hit on Kevin McDougal. Looks like Kevin's going to have to take a moment here.
Defensive coordinator, haven't been decided yet.
Let's go. Use all
and we need the fans to vote. We know who you think are the announcers of the year. Obviously, Chris Marlowe, Brian Bosworth, Rex, Michael Barkan, and Chris Raggy. You're not going to vote on that, but all everything else, you'll have a vote, right?
Say in that, yeah.
Yeah. Chicago up 6-0. John Avery didn't start the game, but he has played most of the first half. McDougal, quarterback draw. Kevin McDougal.
He's got room.
McDougal at midfield, and McDougal trying to get out of bounds. He's tackled as he gets to the 48. So a good adjustment by Chicago offensive coordinator Steve Endicott. And McDougal rumbles for 30.
And you saw what they did. They put John Avery in motion, went to a no-back set, and left Kevin McDougal with all the space up in the middle, and all the defensive back covering the receivers. Took him about 25 yards to figure out what was going on.
Number 67, the right guard, Benny Anderson, got a great block to spring McDougal.
Green 88.
Chicago trying to add to its
Green
lead.
88.
First down.
Set.
Avery, flea flicker, McDougal, throwing deep, Junior
him.
Lord is out there,
he got him!
Inside the five.
I was wondering when Chicago was going to stop being conservative and be a little creative.
42 yards on the pass play, McDougal to Junior Lord.
Well, you certainly didn't want to see Chicago wait for the second half to dip into that bag of tricks. They picked the right time to do it, and they got Orlando in the right coverages. Just a little flea flicker. It shows you the strength in McDougal's arm. Junior Lord got him behind coverage. Did a great job of catching that ball.
LaShawn Johnson replaces Avery. Johnson drives inside the five, tackled by Jimmy Clements.
Ooh. Boy, that ball almost slipped through. Ah, you know, it almost doesn't count the
ball. Now he's got it, Bosworth. You used to tuck your balls. Your ball, I mean. he had it right there.
That's right.
Junior Lloyd with a big play. Second and goal. Thanks, Junior.
Green 88.
LaShawn Johnson. Gets the toss. Johnson hit, breaks the tackle. Johnson hit, and he squirms to the two. Boy, I tell LaShawn Johnson, he dishes it out and he takes it.
He certainly can, and he got around the corner because Willie Tate did a great job of still blocking. He just unfortunately ran into too many Orlando Reds players.
We got 16 seconds.
Aren't you got 16 seconds? If it's a play on the field, you got to run right to the referee and call time.
John just trying to find a seam to go through. If it isn't there, he's going to make it. He didn't go down the first time. Too many long plays the second time.
Timeout's been called.
The field goal puts us two scores up now. Yeah, it's a hell of a deal on the flea flicker.
Yeah.
All right. They're matching up.
I know, good. All right, Kevin, let's get it yourself now. Is he there with you?
Yeah, I'm right here.
Yeah, we're going to go this time.
Trips
Roy. Tell him to oversplit, Kevin.
Tell him to oversplit. Now we're going
Roy, quad right.
Quad right.
QB draw.
Roy. Trips
Roy.
Quad right.
Roy, quad right.
Roy, quad right.
Back squad.
QB draw.
QB draw.
And tell him to oversplit.
They're going to try that same play that they had success on to start this drive. Kevin McDougal, they're going to try to split everybody out. Quad right means receivers two to the right, two to the left, and they're going to get the linemen to get a little bit bigger split as well. See if they can't get a rush upfield by the defensive lineman of Orlando.
All right, look for the quarterback draw. 16 seconds to play. Third and goal from the two.
They still have two timeouts left.
2:44.
Avery's the running back. It is the draw. And it's a touchdown, Chicago.
Von Myers, Coach Endicott, called him all the right plays the first half.
Chicago enforcers get their first touchdown. And now they'll try for an extra point.
Jumbo left, 17 on one. Ready? Oh, yeah.
Give they'll up, try from one. The two.
Green 88.
LaShawn Johnson. He's in there.
The soil. North and south. LaShawn Johnson.
You know, LaShawn Johnson diagnosed with cancer, lymphoma, back in 1998. Last week, he went for another checkup in New York. He had the blood work and the CAT scan, etc. And what a comeback he has made, Brian Bosworth. Over 100 yards last week.
Against the XFL's number two rated defense in the league. They don't drop off that much when LaShawn Johnson comes in the game. LaShawn Johnson runs north and south, and so does Kevin McDougal for the six. Great call at the right time. A great job of blocking up front for Chicago's offensive line.
Christopher Perez, Rob Murphy, Paul Janis, Benny Anderson, and Tony Ramirez, the offensive line.
LaShawn Johnson coming up, finding that little crease. Getting that all-important point after.
So 13 seconds remain first half. Kevin McDougal, 4-1 as a starter, and what a godsend he has been for the Chicago Enforcers. The Enforcers starting the year 0-4, and now they're in command.
We gotta keep it going, baby. We gotta keep it going.
If they win tonight, they're headed to the playoffs. 13-0 Chicago. Set to kick off is Crosland. And he hops a bouncer. Reginald Doster to the outside. And Doster takes it up near the 33. Orlando has come from behind this year four times in the fourth quarter to win games. And they're going to have to put on quite a show in the second half, apparently, Brian Bosworth, to get back into this one.
But they have not been shut out that I know of the entire year in the first half, and that's what they're staring right in the face right now, 13-0 in Chicago against this Chicago team and these Chicago fans, because they want to go to the playoffs.
Chicago in a deep prevent defense. And Orlando takes an in.
We're good. Yeah, we're good. John, give me an injury report right now. How you feeling?
I feel good. Guys are stepping up for me, picking up the slack. Kevin got more rushing yards than me right now, but I ain't mad. Happy birthday, Tori. Love you're, you, girl.
You're playing the ultimate decoy out here today, though, aren't you?
Yeah, I don't mind. As long as we get it done.
Derek Clark, you've got a prolific scoring offense, yet you haven't been able to move the ball on this team, a statistically weak.
Now we got to go ahead and talk about it at halftime, and I'll turn this thing around.
So the Chicago Enforcers are one half away from making it to the playoffs. They lead it 13-0. Glad you're with us on UPN for primetime football. The Orlando Rage, the number one team in football, and the Chicago Enforcers. And so far, it's been all Chicago as Ivy spreads his way up to the 27-yard line. The Miller halftime stats, brought to you, of course, by Miller Genuine Draft.
Hey, look at that, passing yards, two from Orlando.
That's not good.
That's not vintage Orlando football. The turnover is a big big factor. That gave them 3 points. But the emotion is what you don't see as a graphic on there. And Chicago's had all the emotion so far today.
New York won earlier, 22-0 over Birmingham. They sit, they watch their TVs. They're watching right now and hoping that Orlando can turn it on and come back and overtake Chicago. McDougal, 7 of 10 for 83 yards. John Avery bounces it to the outside. He's getting a block from Bailey out there. And he runs for about 7. Cedric Clark running him down.
And John did a great job of baiting the defensive players for Orlando up inside, and then he found a little burst of speed there to bounce it outside and get a quick 8-1.
First down.
Let's go. Up left, 5 belly, first down, ready?
John Avery, 5'9", 180 pounds, 25 years old, out of Mississippi. Not big, but very, very elusive. skips his way for about three. He's got a first down. For the Chicago offensive line,
good job.
Blocking well, and Avery running from behind.
You know, it's ironic because that offensive line for Chicago has been banged up all year long. They had to move tackles to guards to center, and they've done a great job coming down the stretch to put three wins back-to-back-to-back together to put themselves in a position to make the playoffs.
Yeah.
Ron Meyer says the offensive line is as good as it's been for us all season. On first down, they give it to Avery. On the reverse, Leverson nearly had him, and now he is buried. So a great defensive play by Orlando. James Burgess coming in to blow it up.
You better go down, bro. You better go down.
You better go down, bro. That's good advice, boss.
Well, you know what? Orlando is a smart defensive football team. They don't make a lot of mistakes. They stay home. They do their job. Nobody's more athletic on the run than Jeff Burgess there. He makes the big plays, he stays at home, he does exactly what he has to do.
What we got here?
Take it.
Burgess, one of the best in the league, one of the talkies too.
It's on.
388.
Loss of 14, so it's second and 25. McDougal trying to set up the screen. He's got Avery. And the Orlando defense closing very quickly.
The pace of Orlando, just like Coach Galen Hall had mentioned there at halftime, has been picked up here a little bit, and they're flying around a little bit more.
Pay attention! Damn.
Burgess not really known for his pass cover skills. He's a little thick in the hips, but he's able to get out, break down, and make a tackle.
Nothing, boy!
And he'll let you know.
Still up two. Still up dead two. Left, left.
You talk that much, Boz, when you were playing linebacker?
You know, when you're playing, you don't realize how much you talk. And then, you know, here you listen to it. But yeah, you do talk. You do chat. Chatty Cathy's.
McDougal.
He's got him.
Pass complete. Fred Coleman. Coleman's fourth catch of the year, and it's a big one. 32 yards. And how, he beat Stephen Fisher.
And how Fred Coleman got behind Stephen Fisher on a third down like that is beyond me. Kevin McDougal has some time to throw the ball. Finds Fred Coleman downfield. Did a great job. The offensive lineman had given the kind of time he needed to find Fred Coleman downfield.
Exactly right. You give McDougal time. He's a very accurate quarterback. He was the most accurate quarterback in Notre Dame history and one of the top throwers in the XFL in terms of percentage. Just got the playoff. Short pass, complete, a gain of five. Aaron Bailey with a catch.
Reggie Doster playing off of him a little bit. And you got to respect Aaron Bailey, the old veteran. Again, he's got that sneaky, speedy, deep speed that you got to respect because he will do a good job of setting up the defensive back. Before you know it, he's behind you.
Blue 191.
LaShawn Johnson is in at the running back position. Junior Lord in deep motion. Second and four. Johnson. There's nobody that hits the hole faster than LaShawn Johnson. He says, if I have a weakness, it's patience.
Yeah. Yeah, he feels that. And one of the things that he has learned from, ironically, Coach Skipper from San Francisco, who coached him in New York, is how to be patient. Let the hole open up a little bit. Be patient. Watch your blockers. Give them a chance to give you a little alley, and then you can make the big play.
Shake it off now. You all right, buddy?
Ron Meyer trying to guide his enforcers into the playoffs after an 0-4 start.
388. Set.
On first down, McDougal throws it away.
And he threw it away wisely because they had two blitzers coming from the backside, and McDougal was going to pay the price for that one.
Can't handle this. We got you. We're okay. Give it to Kevin.
And Avery, we mentioned that he had not practiced all week, so he's sucking some wind. And playing hurt tonight. He doesn't average what he normally averages, about 5.5 yards a carry.
Yeah.
But tonight he's getting it out for the team in a must-win situation for Chicago. McDougal this drive, 3 of 4 for 40 yards. Another pass coming, he unloads it deep. Five! Touchdown, Chicago!
What a great throw!
Aaron Bailey, 29 yards.
Beat Reggie Dawson. Reggie Dawson was right there with him, but the throw was right on the money.
And the crowd goes crazy. Yeah, we talked about McDougal's accuracy, Buzz.
And he had time. That's why he was so accurate right there. He had the time. It was a three-step drop. It was on time, and he threw it to a spot. Aaron Bailey was at the right spot. Dawson didn't get that bump on him that he needs to at the line of scrimmage. And there's that sneaky speed I was talking about. Before you know it, he's behind you.
Bailey's third touchdown catch of the year. And the enforcers trying to turn 19 into 20.
All day, Just
on the flat.
Let's go. Deshaun Johnson has gotten the carry most of the time in this situation. Right in front of him is Charles Wiley. And Chicago takes a timeout.
Taking another look at that touchdown here. Again, it's the time is the key, and the key is the delivery. It's all the money, and it doesn't get any prettier than that. Dawson's got to get a bump on him at the line of scrimmage. You can't let Aaron Bailey run scot-free down the line, sideline like that.
Well, Stephen Fisher and Reggie Dawson have been alternating in that right cornerback spot. And this time it's Doster who's beaten on a perfect pass play.
That's hard to defend unless you start the defense on the line of scrimmage.
So that ball tossed into the crowd. Those balls, as you know, Boz, cost $80.
Tough to get one of those balls. I got people asking me all the time, can you at least get me a ball?
Aaron, you did a great job of gaining separation at the last minute when you needed it.
Hey, one step close to the playoffs. That's our goal. Go to the playoffs. We're one step.
You're gonna need that. You're gonna need that bonus because you know you're gonna get fined for throwing that ball in the crowd.
Hey, we just gotta keep doing what we're doing. We're gonna make it.
His bonus for this game would be $2,500. I'm told the fine for throwing into the crowd is $2,600. Make a little extra cash for the XFL and Vince McMahon. The point after is coming up. LeSean Johnson.
Green 88.
McDougal throw for it. Lofts it into the end zone. Willie Tate got it.
And here comes another 2,600 in the stands. That team's going right for Chicago. They got a blitz coming right up. Kevin just unloads it. Willie Tate, ironically, never wears gloves, and that's why he can fling it that far up into the stands.
I tell you what, you got to put in some kind of a play for Willie Tate there. He's got a good arm. So the Chicago enforcers and their fans and their cheerleaders and their staff feeling good. Look like they're going to get into the playoffs, barring a miracle comeback.
They're the hottest team right now in the XFL. Their march was 4-1, hot as a pistol, and they're peaking at exactly the right time going in.
And one of the men responsible, the man on the red phone, Kevin McDougal. McDougal has been absolutely outstanding since he was activated earlier in the season.
He really has been the key to their resurgence. When he came in, their offense just became balanced.
Blossom.
Just blossomed, exactly.
Brian Shea is buried. So everything going right for Chicago right now. A reminder that UPN has a new show called Special Unit 2 about a secret division of the Chicago Police Department that hunts down real monsters. Take a look at these weapons.
What's that?
Red ammo.
How many times have you used red ammo before?
Just once on an apartment building.
What are you two so happy about?
We just saved some guy's life and blew up something big. I'd call that a pretty good night.
Special Unit 2 premieres Wednesday at 8, 7 Central, right here on UPN.
Yeah, and Orlando's just not in the groove tonight. They haven't been in the groove really since Jeff Brom got hurt against Los Angeles. It's been a struggle ever since. Kucklick is 3 of 6 with 13 yards. That's just not Orlando football.
Passing game has been completely stymied by the Chicago defense. Second and 10 for the Rage. Pass complete. Over on the far side, a 4-yard gain for Lawrence Hart. Lawrence Hart plays the piano in his spare time. He's not Liberace, but that's a good thing.
It's a soothing thing for him.
160 hooks on one.
What do you now they're going to start going downfield a little bit and see if they can't pick up some bigger chunks of yards. Right now, Chicago's giving them all the little stuff underneath, but they need to start stretching this field.
Critical drive for the Orlando Rays. Got to get something going. Kucklick fires one, and he's got a first down to Mario Bailey. Now Mario Bailey gets eight and a first down.
Now the linebackers for Chicago, they have to start being careful. They can't start biting on the little stuff. Let them have that little stuff because they're baiting you. Before you know it, they'll come in on the 15 to 18 yards behind you, and they'll start getting the bigger stuff.
Hog, hog!
Liz, Liz! Go! Set up!
Kucklick comes another one. And it's going to be very close to the first down. So Kucklick hooking up with Mario Bailey twice.
Good job, Mario.
And that's another first down. So maybe Kucklick starting to get a little rhythm. This is a must-score situation for Orlando.
I think they got to get some points on the board. Chicago's got to start matching. Right now they've got four wide receivers or three wide receivers in. So Chicago's got to start matching Orlando for the personnel they've got on the field.
Just over 6 minutes remaining, third quarter. 20-0 Chicago. Kucklick bounces off Swain, and it's intercepted by Chicago.
Sosa, Dan, Sosa coming down with a rock.
It's Sosa time.
That's another interception, but you can't fault Brian Kucklick for that, other than he might have thrown it a little too hard, but you still got to come down with that ball.
We mentioned earlier that Don Sosa quit the team earlier in the season and then called Coach Meyer and said, I want to come back. And he said, okay, we need you. So he's just returned to the active roster, and it's a nice pickup. He's got a big body and some long hair, Boz.
He's got a really big body, and he's got some really nice hands. And Coach Ron Meyer appreciates those nice hands right now.
Sosa, the former Washington State star, the second turnover for Orlando. 5:58 to play in the third.
He was just getting a feel. And after he threw the ball, I just turned and ran to the ball. It just popped up in the air.
You were so excited a second ago. Show me some emotion.
Oh, man, I can't. Glory to God. I love you guys back in Charlotte. And that was for Chi-Town.
Kevin, that pass had a little too much mustard on it for you. Was it too tough to handle because it was too fast coming?
I just didn't make the play.
What's with this offense tonight? This powerful offense, you guys aren't doing it.
Nothing to say.
Well, nothing to say says it all.
That says it all right there. The first four games, if you don't win the turnover ratio, you don't win games. When you start getting turnovers and you don't give any away, you start winning games, and that's been the key to Chicago's success the second half of this season.
Chicago back on offense. Kevin McDougal having a big night. Fake the end around. And a marker is down. Avery tackled immediately.
I'm hauling the eye. Come on, man. I'm hauling the eye. I can't go out. I got to come out.
And it's a hold against the enforcer.
All right. Well, we got this run ends right here.
Yeah.
Well, run be fine.
They might, but decline it.
They take him back. Take him back. 10 yards.
Christ, squad!
I want. It hasn't been a good night for that man.
66 offense.
Brian
10
Kucklick.
Yards from the previous spot. Repeat first down.
Rob Murphy with the with the infraction there.
Man, the only time we get on camera is when we get called for holding.
Yeah, but it's better than nothing. It's better than nothing. Come on.
At least he didn't get kicked off the island.
151. Pump X.
Upright quick, 151 pump X on one, ready?
20-0 Chicago. Orlando at 8-1, looking at its second loss of the year. His lead holds up. Pump fake. It's not there. McDougal. Some quick feet. That pass is on a bounce. Incomplete.
But did you see Kevin McDougal back there buying time? Looked like a basketball player with those quick feet just coming in and out and getting out of the space. This is what the athleticism of Kevin McDougal gives you back there. This is why the Chicago offense has a force, a balance to that force, and he's been able to do that the second half of the season.
Charlie,
383. Let's go.
McDougal played behind Rick Meyer for 33 years, thought he should be starting. Then when he finally got to be a senior, Boz, he was telling us the other day, they brought in Ron Paulus. Yeah. And Lou Holtz started Paulus right away, and then Paulus broke his collarbone. McDougal went on to have a great senior year, but if not for that, McDougal might never have been a top-flight quarterback.
Okay, he's never,
out of bounds, incomplete.
He's never felt that he's gotten the opportunity or the chance, and Coach Ron Meyer gave him the opportunity. As a matter of fact, at the beginning of the season, Coach Ron Meyer thought that Tim Lester had a better grasp of the offense,
right,
but Kevin McDougal was the better athlete. And in retrospect, Ron Meyer thought he should have gone to Kevin McDougal earlier, and they wouldn't have been in the situation where they are now.
One draw.
Let's go.
First sound.
Quad left, one draw, first sound. Ready?
Go back to that quarterback draw. Put the ball back in the best athlete's hand on the field right now.
McDougal.
At least the healthiest athlete on the field.
McDougal likes this play. Got a touchdown and a 30-yard run on it. Draw play, Avery. Bounces to the outside. Jitterbugging. Avery to the 40 and all the way down to the 38. John Avery, the XFL's leading rusher, playing on a bad hamstring.
And he's just laughing.
Yards.
He's just out there laughing, having a good time.
Okay, I'm asking you early, Boz. You're an expert. If you're Ron Meyer right now, how much do you use Avery the rest of the game? It looks like you have it in control.
Yeah, I don't think I would put him in there, especially in the situation here where he's having a jitterbug and trying to tweak that hamstring. You got a 20-point lead. You got all the confidence in the world in your offense. You got a great backup with LaShawn Johnson that doesn't. You don't lose a lot when he comes in a football game.
Three plays and out for Chicago. The first time we've seen that tonight. Skinny Culver is deep. And that's going to be a violation of the danger zone.
You know, they throw that flag way too fast on that particular play.
You know, Skinny Culver is very skinny, and Dialleo Burks, one of the other Rage wide receivers, we asked him this week, is Skinny a big eater? And they said, yes, Skinny eats and eats and eats. And unlike Brian Bosworth, he doesn't put on weight.
He's got that bird metabolism.
To the 5-yard belt, 22 on the kicking team. 5 yards from the spot of the foul. First down.
So it's up to Brian Kucklick to jumpstart the lethargic Orlando offense. Can he do it? They're down big. They need it.
Coach Ron Meyer, they didn't give him a game ball. The big play of that game was that fourth down interception. Now, granted, he made a play. It wasn't the right play. The right play in a fourth down situation is to knock the ball down. And, you know, he knew that going into that play. And even after he made the interception, he tore himself up inside and said, I should have knocked the ball down. But when the ball is in the air like that, it's just instinctive. You grab it. All over. You come down with the interception, you know what? It worked out well for Chicago.
All right, if you want to get tickets for a playoff game, New York Hitmen or the Chicago Enforcers at L.A., tickets are on sale now in Los Angeles at the Sports Arena box office, all Ticketmaster locations. You call by phone, 213-480-3232, and call 866-LA-EXTREME. And you can log on to XFL.com. So get your tickets now. It looks like it's going to be the Chicago Enforcers at the LA Extreme, but you never know.
I think back to week two, Chicago at LA. That was one great game, and Chicago gave them all they could handle.
And Chicago's much, much better now. Derek Clark.
Hell no, baby.
Gets a yard, maybe. Aaron Humphrey, I'll tell you, these two three linebackers, Humphrey, Baisley, and Austin.
Chicago's,
they are top-notch.
That's right, Chicago's mod squad. They've been monsters the last five games, and that's part of the resurgence of this Chicago defense.
60, smash walk over on one.
Mr. Overcome, two, ready?
There's Jamie Baisley.
Right.
27 years old out of University of Indiana, or Indiana University, excuse me.
Bob Knight mad at you.
Second and nine. I don't want to give you a lead, Bob, but he's gone. Pass caught on the far side. It's Lawrence Hart once again.
Come on,
Kucklick got nailed, but he completed one for 13.
He stood in the pocket and he took the punishment. The backside coverage, Aaron Humphrey comes in here and he blows him up. Big surprise, he plants him down. A little bit of corn there from the Texas Longhorns.
Chicago came out with emotion in this game, and it showed early. Orlando already have clinched a playoff spot in the first seed in the East. Unemotional tonight, at least so far. Still time to do something. Draw play. Derek Clark. And Clark with good yardage out to the 43. Jamie Basley making the tackle, but not before Clark gets 8.
Yeah, it is. Good job.
Derek Clark will get you the big yards right up the middle.
Mario's
he doesn't
middle.
Get you the big yards
zero,
outside. But he can sure hammer you between the tackles, that's for sure.
4.5 yards a carry, a good average number for Derek Clark. Second and 2, a good down for big play potential. Kucklick, straight drop, flushed left, chased by Austin Humphrey, runs him out of bounds. Aaron Humphrey chasing Kucklick out of bounds.
And again, you can see the versatility of Aaron Humphrey. Two plays ago, he was playing on the left defensive end. This time, he's playing on the right defensive end. They put him all over the place because they know how athletic he is out there, and he can pick it up from wherever he's playing.
Humphrey. Liz. Go.
First down for Orlando. Kucklick throws another shorty. This one to Terrence Houston. Pick up 4. You think Orlando needs to stretch it out a little bit? We haven't heard anything from Dialleo Burks tonight.
Yeah, you know, Dialleo Burks caught 3 touchdowns in this in the first meeting, and yet they haven't gone deep to him yet today.
You know, he had the early drop, then he got the penalty, and he's really been out of it ever since.
Yeah, he has not, you know, but then again, Orlando's offense hasn't really been into the click, into the groove, and here's a good opportunity for them to stretch the field deep on the cover, too, as they're playing a tight man corner.
2nd and 6. Cookie fires incomplete. Breaking it up was Quincy Coleman. So Quincy Coleman, 25 years old, out of Jackson State. And a 3rd down coming up.
160 speed war on 1.
They've got Chicago running around. Chicago's defense may be a little tired right now, so take advantage of that.
Snap it quick here.
Go! Set it!
Kucklick.
There he is.
Oh, Dialleo Burks! Dialleo Burks taking it to the house. Touchdown, Orlando!
Talked about it a play ago. Stretch the field with Diallo. They got a cover, too, and he found an open seam.
Heavy!
51 yards.
Beat Darian Boone.
Kucklick to Burks as time runs out in the 3rd quarter. Set deep in the eye.
Go! Set!
Clark straight up the middle, he scores.
Right between the tackles, Derek Clark goes ramming home.
Now we got a marker down. Hold on 1 second.
You only have 10,
Bob. Could come from behind and somehow pull this out. The New York, New Jersey hitmen would squeak into the playoffs and then head to L.A. Just moments ago, it wasn't looking good, but the Rage striking a 50-yard run, a pass and run from Kucklick to Dialleo Burks. So we're set to kick off, just the start of the 4th quarter. A lot can happen in 15 minutes, and it's a high end-over-end kick. Corey Ivey for Chicago. And Ivey's out near the 30. Don't forget, next week on NBC, it will be the San Francisco Demons at the Orlando Rage. That will start at 8 p.m. Eastern, 5 Pacific. That should be a great game. As you may know, Orlando Rage undefeated at home. The San Francisco Demons up 2 weeks ago, down a little bit this week, but they will crank it back up for that one.
Skipper will definitely have those guys ready to play that game, no question about it.
So let's see how Chicago plays it now. First down.
Blue
191.
At their 31-yard line. Chicago going to try to run. They pitch the ball back to LaShawn Johnson. And LaShawn Johnson slams for about five. Tackled by James Burgess. Burgess out of Georgia Tech, constantly talking.
He's the chatty Cathy out there on that Orlando defense.
Huh? That was me. He tried to cut me. It's
on two.
So second and five now.
3:44. Set, hot.
And we've got a flag. We've got contact on the offensive line. Did Chicago move, or was there a touch there? Ben Huff came across.
He was set.
Put his hand down.
Defense. He was set.
Put his hand down.
No, you were set. You got set. This isn't Canada.
All right, Christopher Perez, his dream of getting his name mentioned on television comes true.
Come on. Hey, we're trying to get this
dude.
Come on.
Let's go. Half right. Four belly ghost on one. Ready?
So Chicago with a second and 10.
244.
Orlando blitzes. LaShawn Johnson, we've got markers down. And this one's going to come back.
Don't worry about it, bro.
Got a temporary problem with the microphone of Brian Bosworth. We're working to correct it.
Sabotage.
There you go.
Sabotage.
There's only one way to shut you up, and that's to turn off your microphone.
Hey, you know what? I'm lucky enough to get to work with the big black ball. So you know what? I'm going to say what I want to say.
All right. The Chicago offense.
Quick.
Cooking tonight.
Let's go.
Average 18 points a game. They've already got 20.
202 on one. Ready?
A second and 20 now. Ron Meyer has to decide, how do I play this? Do I play it conservatively? Do we let it hang out a little bit?
You know, certainly don't want to give Orlando any more momentum than they got in that last drive.
Now, Chicago's going backwards after a couple of penalties. He's got the slant to Aaron Bailey. I'll tell you what, Bailey is one of the best in the league at catching the ball and making that pivot out of trouble.
No question about it. He's got those nifty moves, and he can create with those nifty moves the yak, the yards after catch, and that's exactly what he did right there.
I'm trying not to, man. My fault.
Bailey got 11 of it back. So an important third and eight now for Orlando. The Orlando defense needs a stop here.
Drag on one. Ready?
Look for a short drag route right across the face.
388.
Orlando's defense here.
388. Set, hunt.
Blitz. Chicago needs eight. They loft it up, and it's caught. Was he in bounds?
He gives it, what a great
he got
catch.
It. Fred Coleman, 18 yards on the catch. You know, he doesn't catch a lot of balls, Boz, but the ones he does.
He's definitely caught a couple of big ones tonight, and he just caught that one against Ricky Bell, who just came back after being injured really the whole season long with that turf toe. Comes down with a big grab right there.
And once again, a perfectly placed pass by Kevin McDougal.
Absolutely. You gave him time. He'll find the receiver, and he'll put it in the right spot. He doesn't put it in a position where the defensive backs can get their hands on it.
Freddie Coleman, the big play man tonight, averaging 25 and a half yards a catch.
Blue
clock
99.
Ticking, 12:17 to play.
Blue
Chicago
99.
20, Orlando 6. LaShawn Johnson takes a big hit and gets near the 45. A pickup of four. LaShawn, 30 years old, out of Northern Iowa. A tremendous player in the NFL before he contracted lymphoma, cancer, beat it in 1998, was cleared April 12, 1999, and has made a full recovery. Couldn't be a nicer guy in the XFL, Boz, that we've interviewed.
No question.
A delight, and you like to see a victory story. It looks like they're going to change his shoes. Go to a different pair of Nikes there, Boz.
Put some jets in the back of those Nikes.
Or put some warmers in those toes. Wiley into the ball game. You know, the coach is raving about Charles Wiley.
that Corey Gilliard just came up from his safety spot and unloaded on Charles Wiley. And Charles Wiley is one of those backs that Ron Myers believes is just happens to be stuck behind the two best backs in the XFL. Charles Wiley is equally as good as those other two. He just doesn't get the kind of carries that Coach Ron Myers would like to get him.
You know, before that one, he had 6 carries for 3 yards, scored 2 touchdowns. We asked Ron Meyer about Wiley. He said, hey, he's pretty good. He blew out his knee at Georgia Tech, kind of scared some people off him. But he likes Wiley, and Wiley's going to get a chance to play a little in this fourth quarter.
Blue 44!
Third and 2.
Sam Hunt!
McDougal throws and the pass is batted down. Ben Huff, no relation to Bill Duff, knocks it down.
Get the Huff and Duff show over there on that side.
And look, Huff and Duff are huffing and puffing as the Orlando defense has been on the field a lot, but that was a big stop. And now Orlando going to get the ball back.
And this is what you got to do on short yardage, 3-step drops. You can't get to the quarterback. You got to get your hands up and knock the balls down.
Crosland to kick. It's a live ball at the 16. Skinny cover is deep. Skinny at the 5. Skinny through a hole and he's out to about the 17-yard line.
And Aaron Humphrey comes in with another big play, this time on special teams.
Crowd in Soldier Field jacked up, but Orlando's not dead yet. The race trails 20-6, and when we come back, they'll have the ball, and they'll be looking for more.
And is brought to you by Burger King. In the land of burgers, Whopper is king. By 1-800-CALL-ATT for collect calls. By Gatorade Thirst Quencher. It's in the XFL. Is it in you? And by the motor oil that provides maximum protection. Castrol GTX. Drive hard.
Next Sunday on UPN, it's going to be New York or Chicago at LA. That's right here on UPN starting at 7 p.m. Eastern and 4 p.m. Pacific. The second of two playoff games leading up to the $1 million game. Interestingly, the playoff games, people don't know, those are $300,000 games.
Oh, yeah.
$300,000 to the winning team to split up, and then on to the $1 million game to split up that payoff.
Big money in the postseason here in the XFL.
And of course, the $1 million game will take place Saturday, April 21st at 8 p.m. Eastern. And will take place of the team still remaining that has the best record.
Z160 speed smash whop.
So Brian Kucklick, who hooked up with Dialleo Burks for a 50-yard bomb, comes to the line of scrimmage. His team down 20-6 here in the fourth quarter. Orlando good at coming back in the fourth quarter, though. Swain got a jump. Kucklick with time, throws a rope, Burks over his head.
4-3, no!
We mentioned earlier in the game, Boz, that Orlando had engineered 4 fourth quarter comebacks, and a couple of them very impressive.
That's right, the last couple here, engineered by Brian Kucklick. You know, Orlando knows, and they believe that they can come back. Now, the thing they got to be going in the playoffs is create that confidence they had in the first 6 weeks of the season. Now here they're in a situation again where they have to come back. They believe that they can do that, and Brian Kucklick has got their arm that they can get that done.
Kucklick, draw play.
Ball down.
Was that a fumble?
That's a fumble.
Let's see how the officials
roll. Yes, sir.
Chicago gets it.
Jason Bray.
Jamie Baisley knocked it out, and Bray boogieing with it.
Jason Bray just looked down and just happened to be there. Michael Black, not known for his fumbles, coughs one up big time in the wrong end of the field.
Third Orlando turnover.
It's a simple draw play.
Oh, it was his own guy.
His own guy.
His own guy's helmet. It might have been Dan Collins.
Dan Collins, yeah. Comes in here and he hits the ball right there, separates it.
When things go bad, they really go bad. So now Chicago in great position to perhaps put this game on ice. Just over 9 minutes to go, 20-6 lead, and breaking through.
I already know what you're going to do.
Yeah, Ben Huff again.
LaShawn Johnson tackled for a loss. Huff.
Huff's just not going to sit back there and watch this game go away.
That's the story of the game right there, Buzz. You said it good.
I'm just repeating what you said.
Well, that's why I said you said it good.
Because great minds think alike.
Keep doing what you're doing.
Thanks, sir.
Follow my lead.
I will.
Michael Black. Oh, that was a costly fumble. And now Chicago with a second and 13. Pitched the ball to LaShawn Johnson. Oh, he is thrilled. And so the Orlando defense has a little momentum now.
You got pushed in the back here.
That was Kevin Jefferson with the big hit.
Kevin Jefferson slicing up there like a linebacker should, then unloading on LaShawn Johnson.
Clock continues to run, however. Third and 15 for the Chicago Enforcers. If you're the Enforcers, you run again here?
I don't think you get greedy here. I think you can go ahead and take a shot.
Steve is
if it's not
the
there, you can throw the ball away, but you don't want to get in a situation where you throw an interception. You got to get 3 points out of this at least.
Third and 15, draw play. LaShawn Johnson, pretty good yardage, but it's not enough for a first down. Got about five, and now let's see. Andy Crosland will attempt a field goal.
He's 2 for 2 on the night. This is well within his range here, 32 yarder.
He's had a couple blocked this year. He's made one from 19 and one from 42. This one a 32 yarder. He got it. So Chicago puts three more up. And things starting to dim, not only for the Orlando Rage, but the New York, New Jersey Hitmen. A note to all of our local stations along the line. We have a station break coming up. We'll return to Chicago after these messages. You're watching the XFL on UPN. Chicago Enforcers, 6 minutes and 57 seconds away from the playoffs. The Enforcers have dominated the Rage tonight in a must-win situation. They've done it offensively, defensively. They've created some turnovers. And they've done it, as you suggested in the open, Boz, they've done it with emotion.
Yes, and that's the way you win big games, especially at the end of the season. And you want your emotion riding high as you go into the postseason. Right now, Ron Myers told us this week that nobody wants to face off against this Enforcer team because they feel that they're a team of destiny, so to speak, and that's what Ron Myers has preached to this team all year long.
Chicago has won three in a row, four out of its last five. Galen Hall has to be concerned about the way his team has played tonight.
He certainly looks worried there.
Yeah, his team, he said, was going to go all out, but you can see that their heart just wasn't into it. This game virtually meaningless to the Rage. Brian Shea bringing it back. And he brings it out to the 35. Two playoff games next week. Two $300,000 games. The San Francisco Demons at the Orlando Rage in the Citrus Bowl. That's on NBC. Saturday night, 8 p.m. And then it looks like Chicago is going to take a flight out to Los Angeles and do battle once again with the LA Xtreme. Remember, in week two, 39-32 in overtime.
That's going to be a dandy.
Yeah, that's on UPN starting at Sunday, starting at 7 o'clock Sunday night on UPN. Orlando will try to crank it up one more time. The short pass trying to set up the screen to Brian Shea, incomplete. Kucklick tonight, Boz, 9 of 16, 105 yards, a touchdown, and an interception.
And he's been rushed. He's not been in his game. He hasn't made the big plays like he did the previous couple of games. He hasn't made the big interceptions either.
Gun.
Hog.
All right.
Hog.
Over.
All right.
Hey, I'm going too.
Yep.
Second down.
Rip.
Cheat over there. Cheat.
Go.
Watch it quick.
Kucklick all day to throw, and it's tipped incomplete.
Just rifled that ball in, put a little bit too much mustard on that one.
Yeah, I know it, yeah.
Bounce him up, and those 60 hooks.
Gotta get pads sticked.
Galen Hall, one of the most most organized coaches in the league. What a job he has done this year, Buzz.
He's had his coaches with him from the NFL Europe be with him down there in Orlando, and it shows that the continuity has been very, very good all year.
So we've got a procedure penalty coming up on Orlando.
Prior to snap, false start, 68 offense, 5 yards, the down remains third.
Well, Coach Galen Hall, he's won in Oklahoma, he's won in Florida, he won in the World League, in NFL Europe, here in the XFL. And he wins because he has the ability to adapt to the players he has, and he makes them work within his scheme.
Bingo switch.
Kucklick, 4 out of his last 5 passes incomplete. They'll try on 3rd and 15. Pass complete to Bailey. He's going to be way short of the first down.
Yeah, and Chicago's not going to give Orlando anything cheap and easy. They'll give them all those little patterns that come up, and they'll break down and they'll make the good tackle, but they're not going to give them the cheap scores.
You got it.
You know, they didn't have a category in our flashback, Boz, or on our voting. But how about Ron Meyer for XFL Coach of the Year?
Absolutely. After starting 0-4, left for dead on the doorstep, he's brought this team back only because he believed in them and his players believed in themselves.
High spiral. Luke Leverson. And Leverson is taken down over on the far side. 37-yard punt, 3-yard return. And Chicago will try to work the clock now. The Chicago Enforcers getting closer and closer and closer to the playoffs. 4 minutes, 36 seconds remaining in this one. It's all over, but the shouting Chicago leading 23-6. And they have done it behind terrific quarterbacking by Kevin McDougal, running of John Avery, LaShawn Johnson, a very stingy defense. Brian Kucklick has given it his all, but it's not been enough. The Orlando Rage playing unemotionally, uninspired tonight. Meanwhile, the Enforcers higher than a kite, like the old Oklahoma Sooners, Boz. Higher than a kite.
Get the ball!
Well, you know, Chicago has dominated both sides of the ball, and they've done it with 38 players. There's a new quarterback in there, Greg Whelihan, the quantum leap guy, because every time you blink, he's in a different uniform.
Acquired in a trade from Memphis. Ron Meyer likes him a lot, feels confident with him. McDougal goes to the bench. I think this is a good move. 13 of 20, 182 yards, and a touchdown. He also rushed twice for 34 yards and a touchdown. So McDougal, a big night. Greg Whelihan is in. Charles Wiley is the running back. He gets the toss. And so Chicago just wants to hold on to the ball now. Burn a little clock. There's the former Notre Dame Fighting Irish. Good numbers, Boz.
He did a great job tonight. He didn't make any mistakes. No interception. He made all the right plays.
And the crowd gives him a big cheer. He is the man here in Chicago along with John Avery. Craig Whelihan, of course, the former Charger. Back in 98, he started 14 games for the Chargers. 29 years old, played his collegiate ball at Pacific. And a timeout taken by Chicago.
Craig Whelihan did a great job last week when McDougal got his fuzzies knocked a little bit. Craig came in 4 for 5 in a drive where they really needed to move the ball down against New York.
Okay, apparently that was not a timeout. Chicago had too many guys in the huddle. So play continues.
Green 55!
3 minutes to play. Exactly.
Green 55!
Set up. 3rd and 14. And breaking up the middle. And Charles Wiley has the first down for Chicago.
And you can see why
it is a first down.
You can see why Coach Ron Meyer is high on this Wiley kid. Burst through the hole there with a tremendous amount of speed, going straight north and south here. In that case, just going north. 4 rushes, 30 yards right there.
25 years old, 6'1", 220. Here's and Ron Meyer getting closer. What a win this is going to be for his team and the city of Chicago. Got a good crowd turning out tonight.
Green 88!
Watch the Enforcers. There's Wiley again, and he's tackled. You know, we have a moment, Buzz. You have to give some kudos to the New York, New Jersey Hitmen. You know, a lot of people wrote them off early, a lot of criticism early, but they responded. They came back. They had a good second half of the season. They're organized now, but it's just a little bit too little, too late.
The Chicago team is just a little bit better team than New York.
2 minute warning, and John Avery, he's got the feeling that the enforcers are going to the playoffs. The Harvest Moon here in Chicago, shot by ace cameraman Bill Morello. But what a night it has been for the Chicago enforcers, coming in a must-win situation. And they have pounded the number one team in the XFL, and they're doing it with authority, Brian Bosworth.
It's got to make Coach Meyer feel good that over the last four games, or actually five, they've beaten the best defensive teams in the XFL, Las Vegas, San Francisco, at New York. They came in here in a must-win situation, like you said, Chris, and they pounded this Orlando team. They've beaten the best going down the stretch. And you got to think that they got to be favored in the playoffs as one of the top teams that could certainly take the million-dollar prize.
In week two, they took L.A. to overtime with Tim Lester at quarterback.
I don't know of another team that's playing with as much confidence on both sides of the ball as Chicago is.
Ron Meyer said during the break that he might take a knee here. Let's see if he does.
He does.
But Orlando has three timeouts. I wonder about this spot. Look, the clock's still running. Didn't they take timeout?
No,
that's
only if
the clock is running. He took timeout, didn't he?
No, I think Orlando is just going to be content to let this clock run out. And the Gatorade douse is coming up.
Look out, Ron Meyer, baby!
You better be glad, Ron. It's about 60 degrees or 55 degrees in Chicago. 2 weeks ago, it was like minus eight.
So apparently, Orlando has said it's over. Chicago's going to take the knee, and Orlando is going to go home with their timeouts.
And Orlando's got to go home and answer a lot of questions about their team. This is not the same Orlando team that dominated the first 6 weeks of this season.
Look at Meyer. What a happy face he's got.
And that's not the same Ron Meyer that was the first four games of the season. He's going to leave this field with a smile on his face and an opportunity to go to the playoffs.
And look at that, LaShawn Johnson actually distracting Meyer so they can give him the soaking. And he got out of the way. Look at him. LaShawn Johnson, the accomplice tonight. So the Chicago enforcers, and now Chicago takes timeout. Hey, it's a wacky world in the XFL, isn't it, Buzz? 46 seconds to play, 23-6. Chicago is going to even its record at 5-5. Orlando is going to drop to 8-2. More in a minute. Stay with us. Along with Brian Bosworth, Michael Barkan, Chris Reggie, I'm Chris Marlowe, John Avery celebrating. Chicago is going to the playoffs. Just 46 seconds remain. Avery could be an MVP candidate. I don't think he's going to beat out Tommy Maddox, but he had the groove on tonight playing hurt, and he was really an inspiration to this Chicago effort.
No question about it. And I like your choice of Ron Myers as the coach of the year.
So Chicago in take a knee mode, but they will kick it away. You can't give them that one. And Skinny Culver, no, but it's Mario Bailey. And Bailey is going to be submarine near the five. So it's back to the drawing board for Galen Hall. He lost his star quarterback, Jeff Brohm, and has really shown. Kucklick is a very good football player, but he's really not the leader, the presence that Jeff Brohm is.
No, and you know, it's funny, I spoke with Coach Galen Hall at the very beginning of the season during training camp, and he liked Brian Kucklick. He thought he was a great prospect, liked him for his backup. But the key in the XFL is to keep your starter as healthy as long as you can, and you want them going into the playoffs with a healthy quarterback.
Only one quarterback has gone all the way this year. That has been Tommy Maddox. And Orlando just trying to run out the clock and get out without an injury.
Run it out, baby.
Mike Black with the short carry. So what a night for the Chicago enforcers. 20 seconds to go, and the Enforcers are in the playoffs after an 0-4 start and a standing ovation for Ron Meyer. That's going to be the final play of the game. The Enforcers will go to LA and play on UPN for $300,000 and a chance to get into the million-dollar game.
Congratulations to the Chicago team. They played hard all year long. They never gave up. They waited the last game of the season, and it paid off.
Coach, you start 0-4, 5-1 later, here you are, headed to the playoffs.
Oh, well, it's Soldier Field in Chicago, right there. Hey, and over there. God love them. What a great fans they are. There's no question about it. And how about the defense? You know, it comes up with great turnovers.